What a lovely fall day it is. Even though there's not sun out, it's still bright and we can see the colors of the trees. And Steve and I, and Deborah, are so happy to be here again. Thank you. Thank you all for having us. Thank you, Joanne and Anne. We're going to start with a song called Love from the band Sugarland. Some of you know them.
Dedicated to enriching lives through affirmative prayer, education, and service. And as always today, I want to thank all of our ushers and greeters who have worked tirelessly to keep us safe. We are so grateful. Also, kudos to our videography team. We'll be talking more about them during the annual meeting. Carol Bullock is our videographer today. Thank you, Carol, for joining the team. Give Carol a hand. REP, Hope Dotson, and all of you for carrying on last Sunday when I practiced self-care and took a day off. So thank you, Anne. Your lesson was beautiful. I watched it online. So as always, please take every precaution for your own safety. Unless you have a medical reason not to, please wear your mask above your nose and let's all honor the 6-foot distance. Also, when the ushers invite you to exit, if you're not staying for the annual meeting, please go directly to your car. So today is our annual meeting. We'll pretend it's the last Sunday in April, right? Which we were supposed to have it. So if you are willing and able to stay, we would love to have you. We'll give you a comfort break in between the service and the meeting. Please honor the 6-foot distance during that time. If you choose to remain in your seat, that's fine too. Well, restrooms have been cleaned both upstairs and downstairs, so we'll make sure that we let everybody finish before we start the meeting. Just a note of information, everyone is invited to attend the meeting, but only active members are allowed to vote, so that's the way our bylaws read. Also, I would like to have a quick 5-minute, honestly, stand-up meeting with the Capitol campaign team in the adult classroom between the service and the annual meeting. Just come directly there, 5 minutes, and we'll be done. Lastly, I'm told this morning, which I didn't remember it, that next week is a time change already, and so it's fall back, right? Spring forward, fall back, so you get an extra hour of sleep next week, yay! And if you come early, we'll put you to work, I promise. So with all that said, I also want to thank all of our chaplains who, not yesterday but last weekend, came for our combined unity training with all the other unity churches. We managed to do chaplain training, staying 6 foot apart for the entire day. We ate on the parking lot. It was a little breezy, but we made it, and we did prayer all day, 6 foot apart, and so we were honored to host that, and our First Unity Prayer Chaplains took a big role in leadership for that. So thank you all. You're an amazing group. And speaking of that, I now would like to invite Gladys Young, our prayer chaplain for the day, to come up and read the daily word. Gladys?
My name is Gladys Young, and along with Mary Tumanello, we are honored to be your prayer chaplains for today. You will find us after the service in the corners of the sanctuary, so please do come and pray with us. Remember that your prayers are always held in the strictest of confidence. And so now our word for today is listen. In the quiet of my heart, I listen for the voice of Spirit. Would you say that with me? In the quiet of my heart, I listen for the voice of Spirit. During the course of a busy day, I may hear all kinds of things, conversations, music, sounds from nature, traffic noise, and even my constant self-talk. Sometimes all that I'm hearing may numb me to the more intentional act of listening. I listen, I become aware of the voice of Spirit. Its comforting, guiding presence feels like a homecoming. As I settle into a tranquil environment, I begin to relax my body and my mind. I create a welcoming space for listening to the assuring voice of Spirit, discernible as my inner knowing. I breathe deeply, and I rest in this peace, this space. I go about my day listening attentively for all the voice of Spirit expressing through all the people in my life. And from Luke chapter 11, verse 28, we read, "Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it." Let us pray. Dear Father, Mother God, as I harness my thoughts and relax my body, I am able to journey within to the closet of my soul. Here in this stillness, I listen, I feel, your presence. In quiet contemplation, in prayer, and throughout my busy day, I can create a space for listening. I listen for that inner knowing. I listen for the guidance. I listen for the direction. Listen, feel God's inner promptings. Listen, be still. And so it is. Amen.
Granddaughter Kelly was a toddler. She was spending the day at our house one day, and her grandpa started teasing her. Bob will remember this. She asked him to stop, and he didn't. So she took him by the hand and led him through the hallway by a door and said, "Sit, Grandpa." So Bob dutifully sat down, and he said to her, "Ellie, is this some sort of a game we're playing?" And she shook her finger at him and said, "No, Grandpa, you in time out." I'd love to tell that story now. She's 15, but it's a great story. So in the last few weeks, we've been talking about hallways and doors, change and transition. In the book, Hell in the Hallway, Light at the Door, Reverend Ellen Davenport uses the metaphor of the hallway to describe that middle stage of transition, what Robert Brummett calls the void. The hallway, or the void, is a period of uncertainty. In many ways, it's a composed time out, a time away from life as we knew it, and a time when we're not sure what comes next. That's still a mystery. So Reverend Ellen writes, when she talks to people in hallways of hell, they often ask, "Where is God?" Ellen acknowledges that belief in a divine presence can provide great strength and comfort to those grappling with change. She writes, "People want to release the weight of the world to stronger shoulders and trust that out of chaos, order will emerge." But she says, and this might be a little surprising to us, she says, "I am not advocating a divine rescue from chaos." She fears that turning to a big, strong God who is supposed to fix everything comes with the risk of losing our faith when it does not turn out quite as we had hoped. We set ourselves up for disappointment if we just plop a chair down in the hallway and wait for God to open a door for us. That's a mistake. It's sort of like the man who prayed for years and years that he would win the lottery, and finally he became disillusioned and he screamed at God, "God, why haven't you granted my request?" Suddenly he heard a big booming voice from above that said, "Help me out here, son, buy a ticket." It's an old joke, but it does reflect the belief that God is the great fixer. Ellen writes, "The God you need is not up in the sky fixing. The God you need is within you. In the hallways of your life, your own divinity is being called forth. The way you express God in human form will have to be part of your new beginning," of that last stage in the transition process. She notes that it might seem like a paradox to say that on the one hand we create our own experiences, and on the other hand we surrender to a greater power, a power greater than ourselves. But actually both are true. Yes, we can use the perfect creative energy of God to design the kind of lives we want and deserve. And yes, it is also possible to let go and let God during the process. Now, in terms of the transition process, we usually think about the letting go piece as going with the ending stage, don't we? But Ellen writes, when you are in the hallway, a moment might occur when you stop lingering in the past and also stop projecting into the future. When you release all thoughts of how things ought to be and might turn out and simply experience the way things are. No labels, no judgments, no agenda, no resistance. Just let it be. Accepting what is, staying in the present moment, you begin to erase your suffering. Ellen calls this surrender, what I'm today calling sweet surrender. Now, in our human skin, surrender doesn't sound all that sweet, does it? If we're honest, it can seem like a bitter, dirty word. We picture giving up, quitting, waving a white flag, succumbing to weakness. And yet, we only have to look at nature to see the power of surrender. Right now in this season, we see the trees surrendering their leaves to make room for new growth. A caterpillar surrenders and becomes a butterfly. An acorn surrenders and becomes a mighty oak. The old is released to make room for the new. Now, Reverend Ellen says she defines surrender as giving up the stubborn belief that life should be fair and make sense in any given moment. Have you ever noticed that's not always true? And according to the Jafalas, authors of the quest, surrender doesn't mean giving up at all. It simply means letting go of our attachment to the outcome, releasing worry and concern about the results. As long as we cling to the idea of the way life is supposed to be in our heads, our life circumstances will seem beyond our control. Seeing ourselves as powerless victims, we fail to embrace the infinite possibilities of good that are always present. As spiritual beings having a human experience, the truth is we don't always see the big picture, the whole picture. As Paul wrote to the Corinthians, now we see in a glass darkly, but eventually face to face. Now I know only in part, but then I shall know as I am known. This is Paul's reminder to a spiritual community that the power of God is everywhere present, always eager to express, available to us every second if we are willing to see and claim it. Eventually, we will experience earthly challenges in full spiritual awareness, and our time in the hallway can help us do just that. Ellen Davenport writes, accepting whatever shows up in our lives is the first step on the spiritual path through the hallway. Accept what happened, accept the way things are, and at the same time, and this is important, at the same time, accept your power and responsibility to design your life from this moment forward. From Martin Kipp, surrender and accept that whatever is happening in the moment, the universe is working on your behalf. You might remember from our study of the Book of Joy that acceptance is one of the eight pillars of joy. The Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu tell us that acceptance, we have to just accept what shows up in our lives, the pain, the imperfection, and the beauty. That's the only place where change can begin, in our acceptance. As Ann mentioned last week, Ellen believes that each one of us, in some way, chooses our hallway experience. But that doesn't mean we always choose the specific circumstance that puts us in the hallway. That might be the case, actually, if we lived on a desert island and there was no one around us. But as Ellen says, we travel together, and that's a great blessing in this life. We travel together. And most of us, at some time or another, will be in a hallway brought by the events of someone else's life. She gives examples of a woman whose son was paralyzed in a diving accident, and a man whose wife is dying of cancer. I personally know a perfectly wonderful, loving set of devoted parents whose only son became addicted to heroin and died of an overdose. Ellen says, "You did not create those circumstances, but if you are involved, you're in a hallway, and the situation can bring you gifts and growth, no matter how horrific it is." I remember years ago being in an advanced metaphysics class at the village when one of the students came flying in the room really late, visibly shaken and disheveled. The teacher was Dr. Paul Hasselbeck, and he asked her immediately what was wrong. "Oh," she said tearfully, "I passed by a horrible accident on the highway. Multiple cars were involved, and many were being loaded into ambulances. It was awful." Then she took a deep breath, and I suspect, remembering that she was in a metaphysics class, tried to regroup by saying, "Oh, I know it all happened for a reason." And Paul stopped, and very gently he said to her, "Well, I don't know if it all happened for a reason, but I know that you and everyone else involved can bring reason to it." As Uni legend Reverend Eric Butterworth says, we cannot always control what happens around us, we cannot always control what happens to us, but we can always control what happens where? Within us. That's exactly right. We can always control our consciousness and our response. The couple who lost their son to heroin, during their time in the hallway in great grief, they decided to use this horrific circumstance to do everything in their power to keep other kids from falling into the same trap. They regularly go to high schools and share their son's story. This is how they are bringing some purpose and goodness to this horrible event that happened in their lives. And a few years ago, my mother entered home care hospice, expected to live only a few weeks. She was in the final stages of congestive heart failure, and my stepfather of 34 years was in the advanced stage of Alzheimer's, and Mom had been his primary caretaker. So our family at the time, thinking we had probably 3 or 4 weeks, made the decision to care for Mom and Paul, to keep them together until Mom made her transition. It turned out that Mom lived 8 months past her expected time. And eventually, we had to provide 24/7 care for both of them. Now, at that time, I so clearly remember where I was standing and what I was wearing when my brother said to me, "This is the first time in my life I've ever been in a situation where no matter what we do, there will be no good outcome." And yet, as I look back on it, in many ways, that time I spent with my mom was a great gift. The advantage of a long illness, as many of you know, is that you have the opportunity to be with the person and to say what needs to be said. I truly felt that as we all took turns sitting with my mom and holding her hand, we were standing on holy ground. In this 9-month hallway, I realized that I could not manage this situation from my only human self. There was just no way. I lacked the energy and the strength. But I did learn to surrender to the presence of God and to rely on my spiritual powers of faith, strength, and wisdom, and I might add, patience at times. This story also exemplifies releasing an attachment to a specific outcome. In the end, we were not able to keep my mom and Paul together because Paul reached the point where we could no longer handle him at home. However, we found an amazing memory care unit for him, and we took my mom to see him every time she felt able, oxygen tanks and all. The beauty of that was that Paul was already settled, peacefully settled in his new home when Mom made her transition. And that was something we had not even considered in our plan to keep them together. Often there's a better plan that we do not see. So in discussing how to surrender and accept what is, Ellen says, many people pray and meditate to find peace in the moment. We know that. Still others, however, have to hit rock bottom and simply give up, which creates a space, an opening for the divine to emerge. Rumi wrote, and we looked at this quote a few weeks ago, "The wound is the place where the light enters you." I love that quote. Reverend Allen says, "No one understands surrender better than those in recovery programs whose first step is to admit they are powerless over their disease and their lives have become unmanageable. Many find strength and comfort in the Serenity Prayer, written by the American theologian Reinhold Niebuhr in 1951. Many of you know this prayer, and I think most of you can see the screen. Would you read it with me together? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Surrender can be a powerful spiritual tool for realizing that what is before us is actually for us." Reverend Ellen says, "Life is like a movie. If we press the pause button and stop on any one scene, it might look ugly or frightening or even impossible to navigate." How many of you have been there? Most of us have. "If we stay with that scene, we'll be stuck there forever and never get to the happy ending, never get to the goodness at the end." In the words of John Lennon, "Everything will be okay in the end. If it's not okay, it's not the end." I love that quote. "If it's not okay, it's not the end." Ellen writes, "Time and time again, I have heard stories in which surrender and acceptance were the turning points in the hallway. Now, they didn't necessarily change the circumstances, but they altered the consciousness of those who were suffering. And of course, we know that that makes all the difference. Surrender and acceptance can bring peace of mind." Well, we said previously during this series that the questions "why me" and even "what next" are really not the right questions. In the hallways of our life instead, we ask ourselves these questions adapted from Reverend Michael Beckwith. First, how can I find or bring good to this situation? If we believe that God is good and that God is omnipresent, everywhere present, then there must be good. There must be good in every single situation. And it's our job to find it. That's part of the work of the hallway. Number two, what can I learn from this? How can I use this to grow? This is just another way of saying, how can this be for me and not against me? And finally, how can I use this expression to be, how can I use this situation, to be God's expression? How can I ask myself, what is this calling me to be? Is it calling me to be love, strength, wisdom, peace? Spiritually speaking, we have dual citizenship. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. And even in the midst of human pain and conflict, we can lift our consciousness to a higher place. We can turn within and know that no matter how dark and hopeless the hallway seems, we are one with a power and presence greater than any earthly challenge. Deep within is all the peace, wisdom, and strength we will ever need. That perfect energy we call God is with us and within us every single moment. And when we can accept what is and engage in sweet surrender in the now moment, we do find peace, harmony, and eventually, in good timing, the light at the end of the hallway. And so it is. Thank you. Keep Let go of questioning or anger and just become still in this now moment. Feel the divine presence of God surrounding and enfolding you now, permeating your very soul. This is the divine part of you that is always strong and always at peace. Breathe into this. Release the whirlwind of what if and what now. Deep within you is a peace that passes human understanding. You are not facing this hallway alone. Whatever is required of you in the days ahead, you will be supported and loved by a power stronger than you can even imagine. No matter how difficult the moments of your life might seem, the energy of love and peace that we call God is with you. You are one in that energy. Surrender to it now for a few moments. Even a few moments of sweet surrender in the silence will bring you peace in the silence. So now, as we return to this room and come together again as a greater spiritual community, we honor and bless one another on this path of individual and collective spiritual growth. We are one with each other and with all humankind. For the love that supports and uplifts us, we are so grateful, and so it is. Amen.
Camps, people dying, COVID, etc. I realized that I really need to lighten up. I was walking down the street, I was feeling mighty fine, when I caught a glimpse in the window of my behind. There was a wiggle and a jiggle that I've never seen before. And as I looked a little closer, oh my God, I found more. Well, I freaked out and I shrieked out, this has just ruined my day. Till I heard a voice inside of me say, lighten up, don't take it so seriously. Lighten up, trust the mystery. Lighten up, it doesn't matter anyway. To meet my friends, I got an outfit that's to die for. I am just the living end. But as I scope out the scene, well, it's obvious to me that the money at this party is simply obscene. They're talking about their mansions and their yachts and dropping names. And in an instant, I feel small and worthy and ashamed. So lighten up, don't take it so seriously. Lighten up, trust. A mystery, lighten up, it doesn't matter anyway. Enjoy your life, get out of the way, lighten up. Worrying and judging, what good does it do when you compare yourself to me? I compare myself to you. I'm looking in the mirror.
first do I stress, it's the thing I most fear. Then I soon realize that I don't have to struggle or try. I've got my mantra and I realize I don't have to change a thing. No, don't struggle, don't try, cause my real beauty comes from deep inside. Lighten up, don't take it so seriously. Lighten up, trust the mystery.
Very quickly after service in the adult classrooms. Don't forget that. And I'm going to keep it about 5 minutes. So now it's that time in our service where we come together just to pause and reflect and give thanks for our many blessings. Your love offerings are so appreciated. We absolutely also appreciate all the many notes we've been getting, notes of encouragement, and most of all, your prayers. We know and affirm that we are one with divine source and one another. So please join me in blessing our many gifts. Together, divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God. So our service will end today with a final song from Steve and Deborah. If you wish to pray with the prayer chaplain, you can remain in your seat, or if you just want to sit there until the annual meeting starts, you can do the same thing. I just want to say we look forward to seeing everybody next week, either here in the sanctuary or in your own home, on our Facebook page or on our website. We actually have had over 400 likes and shares on our Facebook page, and we appreciate that. We appreciate all of our Facebook followers. In oneness, please know that we hold everyone in sacred space of love and faithful prayer, and we know that we are blessed. And so it is. Amen.
And on that note, our closing song is Blessed.